There's a lot of research that's happening at Agriculture Victoria for the summer fruit industry. The overall aim of this research is to remove or reduce that variation that occurs in fruit quality going to the markets. The research here is focused on production, harvest and post-harvest. The research focused on production looks at canopy types, crop loads, rootstocks and irrigation. With different canopy types, this can affect tree growth, vigour, impact yield and fruit quality. Dr. Mark O'Connell from Agriculture Victoria at Datura looked at a number of modern tree structures and compared two-dimensional vertical trellis with three-dimensional Datura trellis for peach and nectarine. He also compared traditional vase tree structures with Datura trellis for plums and apricots. Managing the crop load, that is, through fruit thinning, dictates the number of fruit per tree and directly influences yield and fruit quality.
Beside me we have a Datura trellis system, canopy system, compared to the freestanding vase system. They're both same tree age, same soil preparation, same rootstocks, same tree spacing. And what we've been doing over the most recent years, once these trees reach maturity, we've been varying the crop load, the number of fruit per tree. And we've been looking at the yield, fruit size, and in particular fruit quality. The crop load effects have really been quite prevalent. We've seen huge changes with fruit size. Obviously, if you're higher fruit number, the smaller the fruit, but the higher the yield, which isn't desirable because we need some minimum standards there, around about the 36 grams in apricot. Light interception wise, obviously the larger the tree, as you can see here with the Datura trellis, they intercept more light, they can support a higher crop load compared to the freestanding vase trees.
Different rootstocks were also investigated to try and improve the yield and fruit quality. Rootstock vigour is an important criteria for orchard management and directly influences tree growth and development, yield and fruit quality outcomes. Other agronomic characteristics of root systems include precocity, adaptability to soil, climate, and the tolerance to stress or biotic stress such as nematodes, virus, bacteria, and fungus.
The September Sun rootstock study, we've been looking at obviously Nemigard, the industry standard rootstock, and comparing that to the Alberta, the Cornerstone, a semi-dwarfing Crimps 86 rootstock. Cornerstone and Alberta are producing larger fruit consistently compared to Nemigard, the industry standard, and more skin red colour. And when we look at the information and the yield results and the quality results from Crimps 86, we're finding equivalent fruit size and high skin red colour as well. This is an early season nectarine Rose Bright. And here we have a whole range of rootstocks again. We also have Crimps 1, which is a very high dwarfing rootstock. Compared to Crimps 86, it's a semi-dwarfing against Nemigard and other Alberta rootstocks, which are more high vigour. The findings are similar with the late season peach rootstock study, where we're finding Quarterstone does produce large fruit size compared to Nemigard, the industry standard. Some of the interesting findings with the high dwarfing rootstock, Crimps 1, is that we're getting good fruit size and high fruit colour, but yeah, obviously tree vigour's smaller, less pruning weight, etc.
Mark talks about the irrigation experiment, which examines strategic irrigation management practices on yield and fruit quality.
The findings with the deficit irrigation study has been to confirm some of the earlier work back in the 70s and 80s, where RDI is a very useful deficit irrigation practice in stage two of fruit growth development, which is where the fruit growth slows down and the vegetative growth is high in that period. So what we've done is over a number of seasons, consecutive seasons, is deficit irrigated trees through stage one, stage two and stage three on a September bright nectarine, a late season nectarine. And yeah, we're particularly interested in the yield and fruit quality aspects, which hadn't really been studied before, the fruit quality. So, and the findings reinforce the earlier work that 30-40% RDI deficit irrigation in stage two is no detriment to yield and fruit size, and we also found it was no detriment to fruit quality as well. So that's our recommendation, and in a very tight drought, limited water, limited years, we could also suggest you deficit irrigate in early stage three, which is the period before harvest, straight after the RDI to, stage two window if you need be, and also post-harvest 30-40% deficit irrigate as well.
There's a lot of work in areas to improve harvest timing and fruit maturity. The traditional methods to determine fruit harvest are fruit firmness, colour and bricks, or SUAs, and there's developmental sensors that more accurately measure these attributes and can do this while the fruit is on the tree.
As part of a CRC food agility project, we are investigating and validating and calibrating and testing this unit, a mobile sensing platform, to measure fruit number, fruit size and fruit colour in stone fruit crops. And there's a number of sensors I'd like to point out on this device. Obviously you need a GPS, which is this device here. We have a LiDAR system and we have camera systems with strobe lights. So all this is happening and sensing many times per second as you drive up and down the orchard rows at around 7 to 10 kilometres an hour. So the data is stored on the data logger and taken to back to base for, and interpreted later. And what we've been doing, as I said, is looking at fruit size, fruit number and fruit colour on a range of stone fruit crops from peach, plum, apricot and nectarine. This sensor is non-destructive, obviously, and it measures the fruit attributes of interest, which are fruit firmness, fruit sweetness and maturity. So what we do is, with the smartphone connected, Bluetooth connected, we go up to the fruit and scan the fruit, hit the button, and take a reading. So some of the advantages of this approach and this sensor over traditional wet chemistry destructive measurements is the fact that it is a non-destructive device. So you point and shoot, you get a measurement and a reading. That increases the sample size, it's Bluetooth connected, it's smartphone app linked, and it stores the data.
Christine Vresina from Agriculture Victoria's AgriBiosciences based in Bundoora investigated ethylene production and found that ethylene production was the most important indicator in determining the best time to harvest fruit off the trees.
So one of the key things that I've found throughout this research has been that the maturity of the fruit is paramount to the quality outturn that is going to happen, and the ethylene production that the fruit produce themselves is very important to whether that fruit can ripen properly at the other end. And if there's no ethylene at harvest, then you will get some of those problems happening. Whereas if there is some small amount of ethylene being produced by the fruit, then they will happily go through to full ripening without too many problems.
An initiative to improve export fruit quality in overseas markets focused on supply chain innovation. This was research done by John Lopresti and Glenn Hale from Agriculture Victoria. They worked with some industry exporters and producers to look at how they could improve fruit quality for these exports going overseas.
We're using real-time data loggers in this project because it makes the data more readily available, and if there are any problems or issues with the consignment, then the exporter can potentially do something about it before the fruit gets to market.
So initially they looked at real-time monitoring technology and then monitored the fruit in transit overseas. They then copied that data and used it in simulation trials to determine the impacts of transport and all the other steps on different fruit cultivars. This also led to information about how they could predict impacts on fruit quality.
We've developed flesh firmness and shelf life calculators for Australian stone fruit growers and exporters that are able to predict changes in quality and remaining shelf life along cold chains, either in domestic markets or during sea or air freight. And these calculators are based on three factors: harvest maturity as measured by harvest flesh firmness, the temperature, as well as the duration along each stage of the cold chain.
With these simulation trials, they're also able to determine preconditioning requirements of fruit to reduce the storage disorders that occur in fruit on long journeys going to export markets.
We've found that many cultivars that are currently exported from Australia, Stonefruit cultivars that are exported from Australia, have a limited storage potential of at most 4 to 5 weeks. And this storage potential is generally limited by the development of storage disorders, known as chilling injury. We conducted some trials where we used a method called preconditioning or stepwise cooling. We slow cool fruit from harvest, so instead of down to 0 to 2 degrees, we cool the fruit down to somewhere between 10 and 18 degrees Celsius, and then leave the fruit for 2 days at that higher temperature, and then cool the fruit down once again to the low temperature of 0 to 2 degrees. That slower cooling process actually significantly reduces the incidence and the severity of flesh browning and chilling injury in general after cool storage that simulates sea freight export.
John and his team looked at air freight and the effects of temperature on fruit quality.
We looked at three different air freight temperatures of 8 degrees, which is considered a normal air freight temperature, 12 degrees and 16 degrees. Over a 24-hour period, after these cultivars were handled at these three temperatures to simulate air freight, we put them into storage for up to 4 weeks to see what impact that the higher air freight temperatures had on subsequent fruit quality after storage. So 24 hours at 16 degrees and 24 hours at 8 degrees, which simulated different air freight temperatures, had very little impact on flavour pool nectarine quality, which was a real surprise. On the other hand, poliquid peach, which we know has a short storage life, was impacted by higher air freight temperatures. So an air freight temperature of 16 degrees caused poliquid peach to soften much more rapidly than an air freight temperature of 8 degrees during a subsequent cool storage period. So again, demonstrating that temperature management is critical, but it's actually more critical for some cultivars than others. And robust cultivars, such as flavour pill nectarine, can better handle spikes in temperature along this cold chain.
All the information you've just seen can be found on the Horticulture Industry Network's website at hin.com.au.